यहाँ पर ऊपर जो लेडीज़ का है ऊपर मस्जिद लेडीज़ के लिए है, दो फ्लैट हैं, हमने एक को मस्जिद बना दिया है, एक फ्लैट है तो एक दूसरी साइड पे एक फ्लैट है। ये मेन रिसेप्शन है, औरतों की मस्जिद पर लिया हुआ
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون.
سورة المؤمنون کی پہلی 12 آیات کی تلاوت کا اردو ترجمہ دے مطابق حضرت مرزا طاہر احمد خلیفۃ المسیح رابع رحمۃ اللہ علیہ پیش خدمت ہے. اللہ کے نام کے ساتھ جو بے انتہا رحم کرنے والا بن مانگے دینے والا اور بار بار رحم کرنے والا ہے, یقیناً مومن کامیاب ہو گئے. وہ جو اپنی نماز میں عاجزی کرنے والے ہیں اور وہ جو لغو سے اعراض کرنے والے ہیں اور وہ جو زکوٰۃ کا حق ادا کرنے والے ہیں اور وہ جو اپنی شرمگاہوں کی حفاظت کرنے والے ہیں مگر اپنی بیویوں سے نہیں یا ان سے بھی نہیں جن کے ان کے داہنے ہاتھ مالک ہوئے, بس یقیناً وہ ملامت نہیں کیے جائیں گے. بس جو اس سے ہٹ کر کچھ چاہے تو یہی لوگ ہیں جو حد سے تجاوز کرنے والے ہیں, اور وہ لوگ جو اپنی امانتوں اور اپنے عہد کی نگرانی کرنے والے ہیں اور وہ لوگ جو اپنی نمازوں پر محافظ بنے رہتے ہیں یہی ہیں وہ جو وارث بننے والے ہیں, یعنی وہ جو فردوس کے وارث ہوں گے وہ اس میں ہمیشہ رہنے والے ہیں. جزاک
اللہ. اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم, بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. Beloved Hazur, respected guest, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Firstly, I'd like to thank Hazur Akhtas and Hazrat Begum Sahiba for honoring us this evening to inaugurate this beautiful mosque which Hazur Akhtas has named Tahir Mosque. The brief history of the Jamaat started in 1991 when Raja Masood Sahib arrived from Pakistan and settled with his wife and three children and his brother Raja Mahmood Ahmed in this area. In the early days, the Jamaat included Nasir Khan Sahib by Naib Amir, Ayaz Sahib, who was the father-in-law of Ibrahim Noonan Sahib, and Bushra Javed Sahib. And at that time, Raja Sahib offered his home for the use as a Salat center. The following year, a proper Jamaat was formed, and Raja Sahib became the first president, and his wife became the first Sadr Lajna. During this period, a number of people joined the Jamaat, perhaps the most important being Ibrahim Noonan Sahib, who later became Sadr Majlis Khudam Al-Ahmadiyya, UK, and is now the missionary in charge in Ireland. In 1998, Dr. Shabir Bhatti Sahib was elected president, but the Jamaat Center remained at Raja Sahib's house. In 2001, Dr. Abdul Hafiz Sahib was appointed president when Dr. Shabir Bhatti Sahib was appointed to Central Amla. In 2003, Raja Sahib moved out of the area of Southeast London to take up residence in Tolworth. At the same time, Tariq Chaudhry Sahib offered the use of an annex in his property that composed of two small halls with their own toilet facilities. And this facility was available for 4 years until the property was sold. In 2010, due to widespread area covering the Southeast London Jamaat, it was decided that the Jamaat should be split into two, Bromley and Lewisham, headed by Abdul Momen Amir Sahib, and Bexley and Greenwich, which was headed by Dr. Abdul Hafiz Sahib. The Tahir Mosque was purchased in March 2011 at a price of £570,000, alhamdulillah. This site was acquired miraculously and was a very competitive price despite a lot of interest in it. In fact, one of the bidders at the auction later approached the Jamaat and offering £750,000 plus the offer of constructing a prayer hall serving 200 people free of charge. When this matter was brought to Hazur's attention, he instructed us that we should go ahead and build the mosque independently. There have been some outstanding sacrifices offered by some members of the Jamaat. One member pledged his entire salary for the year, and another member pledged her jewelry, including her hakmer, in order to help purchase the site. But one person or one family that needs a special mention is Dr. Shabir Bhatti Sahib and their family, who made a huge financial sacrifice for this mosque. Alhamdulillah, Tahir Mosque can accommodate 280 people for prayers. It also had two independent flats and car parking for 30 cars. Lastly, it is important to request special prayers for Nasir Khan Sahib and his team, who work day and night to convert this building into a beautiful mosque, with special mention for Naseem Bhatt Sahib, Rashid Sahib, Khalid Nepal Sahib, and our audio video team, Mia Safdar Ali Sahib and his team. That this beautiful mosque is being inaugurated today by Hazrat this. May Allah bless our Jamaat and the tireless effort of its loyal and dedicated members. Ameen.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد للہ کہ آج آپ کو اس علاقے میں اللہ تعالیٰ نے ایک مرکز مسجد مہیا فرما دی. اب اس مسجد کا حق ادا کرنا یہ ایک بہت بڑی ذمہ داری ہے جو ہر احمدی کو اپنے پیش نظر رکھنی چاہیے. صرف مسجد بنا کر اس کی خوبصورتی ظاہری خوبصورتی دکھا کر مسجد کا مقصد پورا نہیں ہو جاتا. مسجد کا مقصد تب پورا ہوتا ہے جب اس میں آنے والے نمازی ہر لحاظ سے پاک دل لے کر اور اللہ تعالیٰ کی عبادت کرنے کی غرض سے حاضر ہوں. مسجد کا نام مسجد طاہر رکھا ہے اور اس لفظ میں آپ کے لیے یہ سبق ہے کہ ہمیشہ اس کو پاک صاف جہاں ظاہری لحاظ سے رکھیں وہاں دلوں کو بھی صاف کرتے ہوئے اس مسجد میں حاضر ہوں. اللہ تعالیٰ نے جو خانہ کعبہ کی بنیاد رکھی اس وقت حضرت ابراہیم علیہ السلام اور اسماعیل علیہ السلام کو یہ تاکیدی حکم تھا. اللہ تعالیٰ فرماتا ہے قرآن کریم میں کہ وَعَاهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَعِيلَ أَنْ طَاهِرَ بَيْتَيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْعَاكِفِينَ وَرُكَّعِ السُّجُودِ, کہ ہم نے ابراہیم اور اسماعیل کو تاکید کی کہ تم دونوں میرے گھر کو طواف کرنے والوں اور اعتکاف بیٹھنے والوں اور رکوع کرنے والوں اور سجدہ کرنے والوں کے لیے خوب پاک صاف بنائے رکھنا. خانہ کعبہ کا ایک مقام ہے اور اسی کی تتبعوں میں ہماری مجالس مساجد قائم ہوتی ہیں. خانہ کعبہ میں تو کے لیے طواف کا حکم ہے, حج پہ لوگ جاتے ہیں طواف ہے, لیکن مساجد طواف کے علاوہ باقی تمام وہ کام ہیں جو پورے کرتی ہیں, جس میں اعتکاف بیٹھنا بھی ہے. رمضان کے دنوں میں اعتکاف بیٹھتے ہیں, نمازوں کے لیے رکوع اور سجود ہیں, نمازوں پہ آنا ہے, اللہ تعالیٰ کے حضور جھکنا ہے. بس اللہ فرماتا ہے کہ یہ مقصد جو ہے اس کو پورا کرنا اور اس کے لیے اپنی مساجد کو پاک صاف رکھنا. قرآن کریم میں اس جگہ جہاں مسجد ضرار کا ذکر آتا ہے آن سلوں کو فرمایا کہ اس مسجد میں کبھی نہ داخل ہونا, تم اپنی مسجد میں داخل ہو جس کی بنیاد تقویٰ پہ رکھی گئی ہے اور جس کو آباد کرنے کے لیے پاک صاف دل رکھنے والے لوگ ایسے مرد ہیں جو ہی خواہش رکھتے ہیں کہ وہ پاک ہوں، وہ اس میں آتے ہیں نمازیں پڑھنے کے لیے. اس لیے اس مسجد میں جاؤ، اس مسجد کو آباد کرو جہاں ایسی خواہش رکھنے والے لوگ آئیں. بس جب آن سلم کو یہ حکم دیا کہ اس مسجد میں جاؤ جہاں ایسے پاک دل رکھنے والے لوگ اور اپنے آپ کو پاک کرنے والے لوگ آئیں، تو یہ ایک مسلسل جاری حکم ہے جو آج بھی جاری ہے ہمارے لیے کہ جب بھی ہم مسجد میں آئیں پاک دل لے کر آئیں، اس خواہش کے ساتھ آئیں کہ خدا تعالیٰ کی پاک ہو کر ہم نے عبادت کرنی ہے، اپنے دلوں کو پاک رکھنا ہے. پاکی کا کیا مطلب ہے؟ دلوں کی صفائی ہے، ظاہری صفائی ہے. قرآن کریم میں بھی اللہ تعالیٰ فرماتا ہے، یہ ان لوگوں کو اس کی سمجھ آتی ہے جو پاک صاف ہیں. بس دین کا علم حاصل کرنے کے لیے اور اللہ تعالیٰ کی عبادت کرنے کے لیے طہارت اور پاکیزگی ایک بہت ضروری چیز ہے. بس اس علاقے میں یہاں کے لوگ جب بھی نماز پڑھنے کے لیے مسجد میں آئیں، مسجد طاہر کا لفظ بار دیکھیں، تو اپنے آپ کو اس سوچ کے ساتھ اس مسجد میں داخل کریں کہ ہم نے پاک دل ہو کر اس میں داخل ہونا ہے، خالص ہو کر اللہ تعالیٰ کی عبادت کرنی ہے، اور پاک دل کے ساتھ ہی ایک دوسرے سے تعلقات رکھنے ہیں، ایک دوسرے کا خیال رکھنا ہے، ایک دوسرے کے جذبات کا خیال رکھنا ہے. اور جب یہ چیز پیدا ہو جائے گی تو یہاں آپس میں محبت اور پیار کی ایک ایسی فضا قائم ہوگی جو دوسروں کے لیے بھی نمونہ ہوگی، اور یہی نمونے جو ہیں پھر معاشرے پہ اثر ڈالتے ہیں، ماحول پہ اثر ڈالتے ہیں. لوگ آپ کو دیکھیں گے، وہی لوگ جن میں بعض لوگوں میں مسجد کی وجہ سے بعض کچھ ریزرویشنز ہوں گی، ان کو خیال آئے گا کہ نہیں، یہ لوگ وہ ہیں جو خالص ہو کر اللہ کی عبادت کرنے والے اور معاشرے کا ماحول کا حق ادا کرنے والے ہیں، اور اس سے پھر آپ کی تعلقات بڑھیں گے اور یہی پھر تبلیغ کا ذریعہ بنتا ہے. بس جب حضرت مسیح علیہ الصلوۃ والسلام نے فرمایا کہ جہاں بھی اسلام کو متعارف کرانا ہو مسجد بنا دو، تو اس کا مقصد یہی تھا کہ جب مسجد بنے گی اس میں آنے والے لوگوں کو دیکھیں گے، ان کے رویے دیکھیں گے، ان کی عبادت کے معیار کو دیکھیں گے، ان کے اعلیٰ اخلاق کو دیکھیں گے، آپس کی محبت کو دیکھیں گے، ماحول میں ان کی محبت اور پیار کے پرچار کو دیکھیں گے، تو لوگوں کو توجہ پیدا ہوگی اور وہ اس سے اسلام کی تبلیغ کے دروازے کھلیں گے. بس اس بات کو ہمیشہ ہمیں اپنے سامنے رکھنا چاہیے. اللہ کرے کہ یہاں آنے والے، اس علاقے میں رہنے والے اس اہم چیز کو ہمیشہ مد نظر رکھیں. صرف نام سے مسجد کی بنانے سے اس کی کوئی اہمیت نہیں، جب تک کہ اس نام کے حقیقی معنی آپ کے دلوں میں قائم نہیں ہوں گے اور اس مسجد کا حقیقی حق ادا کرنے کی آپ کوشش نہیں کریں گے، تب تک وہ مقصد پورا نہیں ہو سکتا جس کے لیے مساجد بنائی جاتی ہیں. اللہ توفیق دے کہ اس مقصد کو پورا کرنے والے سب بنیں. اب دعا کر لیں. آمین.
Priest will occupy it, and
and we have offices and guest rooms of this nature.
But there's a complaint from women's side that this place is too small for them.
Okay, we'll sort that out.
If there's any women rights activists here present, they will raise their voice here.
I'm not saying it was designed by a man and made it too small.
Well, generally we give equal area to both men and women, generally.
Normally, yes.
Normally. But
because
we
have seen that our ladies are more active than men in their activities.
We won't pass the comment.
Especially in our community. Yes. Yes.
How far does your congregation come from? Is it very local? Or?
This is very local here. I mean, we have a very large mosque in Morden, which actually can accommodate over 10,000 people.
Good.
It's the largest mosque in Europe. In fact, in the West. And of course, I think you obviously haven't been there.
No.
I think another invitation for you.
Invitation to you.
We have a peace conference that takes place at the end of March.
Right,
and
yes.
We very much would like you to attend if you can. This is a relatively new community for us.
Yeah.
We have already quite a large community in Croydon and in that area, and this forms part of that.
Right.
Yeah. But we have 100 centres in the UK. 100 centres in the UK.
100 centres, no?
100 centres. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Not the mosque.
No, not mosque centres.
Oh, okay. Right.
But
so
we have
not necessarily places of worship, but
centres. Yes.
Places where we can get together.
Yes.
Sort of geographically, how spread is that then?
Throughout the UK. We have built some purpose-built mosques in different parts. Hartlepool, Manchester is being built now, Bradford, Sheffield, Leamington Spa, Wolverhampton.
That is Bradford Mosque.
Yes.
Quite a big mosque.
And that's Hartlepool over there.
Yes, that is Hartlepool Mosque.
That's right. That's the big mosque which can hold 10,000. And that's the first mosque ever built in London.
Where was that?
In Southfields.
Okay.
It was built in 1924.
Okay.
It's very small but very elegant.
It is beautiful. And did you have to do a lot of work here? Because of course it was
Yes, indeed. It was offices. And I don't know if you had an opportunity to look.
Has
it completely changed? Well, maybe afterwards we'll give you a conducted tour.
It's a building that I used to know very well.
Right.
So, it was a pleasure to meet you, Your Holiness. Simon Davis, very privileged to be here. Thank you.
So, the building process, it went smoothly, did it?
This one here?
Yep.
Yes, indeed. In fact, we had an offer from a housing association. Wanted to take over this building and were prepared to pay us a lot of money for it. But we just wanted to be built as a proper mosque. So we've built it as a proper mosque with the foundations. And I think you will be pleasantly surprised when you see it. Especially that you knew what it was like before.
Absolutely.
I don't know if you remember this room.
I was trying to place it because it just. As you say, it was just offices. There was
no large
central space or
anything. No, that's right, indeed. So when I first saw this room, it was in a pretty bad state. So a lot of work has been done by our teams.
Yeah. You were saying it was what XJRC money or something. So you must be talking about early 80s when it was actually built. So that
it was early 80s.
Yeah, so it's quite a long time,
yes,
and really having been used as offices, obviously would need a good old facelift with this.
Right.
Yeah.
Are we ready inside?
Yes.
I believe that we're ready inside too.
Oh, okay.
To start our
Fantastic. Yeah.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming and gracing us with your presence. We are indeed very honored that in our midst we have the presence of Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad Sahib, who is the spiritual head of more than 150 Ahmadi Muslims worldwide.
Million.
Million. Beg your pardon. Did I say 1,000?
You didn't say anything.
That's nervousness. Sorry about that. So we will present, we'll start this program, as is our tradition, with the translation, with the recitation from the Holy Quran. And I'll request Usman Zahir Saab to kindly come and read out a few verses.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا بني آدم خذوا زينتكم عند كل مسجد وكلوا واشربوا ولا تسرفوا إنه لا يحب المسرفين قل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق قل هي للذين آمنوا في الحياة الدنيا خالصة يوم القيامة كذلك نفصل الآيات لقوم يعلمون قل إنما حرم ربي الفواحش ما ظهر منها وما بطن والإثم والبغي بغير الحق بغير الحق وأن تشركوا بالله ما لم ينزل به سلطانا ما لم ينزل به سلطانا وأن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون ولكل أمة أجل فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ إِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ يَقُصُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ فَمَنِ اتَّقَى فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ
Thank you. Just as the Holy Bible is to the Christians and the Vedas are to the Hindus, the Holy Quran is to the Muslims and far more. Spread across its 114 chapters are more than 6,300 verses, and you heard five. I'll ask Qasid Ahmed Sahib to come and translate them for you.
Assalamu alaikum. I seek refuge from Satan the accursed, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the ever merciful. O children of Adam, take your adornment at every time and place of worship, and eat and drink, but be not immoderate. Surely he does not love those who are immoderate. Say, who has forbidden the adornment of God which he has produced for his servants, and the good things of his providing? Say, They are for the believers in the present life and will be exclusively for them on the day of resurrection. Thus do we explain the signs for a people who have knowledge. Say, my Lord has only forbidden indecencies, open or secret, and sin and wrongful transgression, and that you associate with God that for which he has sent down no authority, and that you say of God what you know not. And for every people there is a term, and when their term is come, they cannot remain behind a single moment, nor can they get ahead of it. O children of Adam, if messengers come to you from among yourselves, rehearsing my signs unto you, then whoso shall fear God and do good deeds, on them shall come no fear, nor shall they grieve.
Thank you very much. And just to reiterate that the Ahmadiyya community is 150 million plus worldwide. And it is, there are more than 200 countries in the world, and the Ahmadiyya community is established in 200 countries worldwide. Each country has a national president, and the national president of the United Kingdom is Mr. Rafiq Hayat, who is sitting three spaces next to His Holiness. And he is ably assisted by regional presidents, and the regional president of this area where this mosque is Mr. Naseem Butt, who will present his welcome address.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, ever merciful. Beloved Hazur, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace, mercy and blessing of God be upon you. On behalf of South London region of Ahmadiyya Muslim Association, I welcome you all to the inauguration of Tahir Mosque, which will serve the boroughs of Lewisham, Greenwich, Bromley and Bexley. I stand here before you with utmost humility and thankfulness to the Almighty God for the outstanding manner in which this region is being blessed this evening. The road that has brought us to this juncture has not been easy, in fact, been a long and difficult one, although there were some community members living in this part of London since 1966. They formed part of Croydon branch, but a separate branch was established in November 1991 by the name of Catford branch, and Masood M. Raja Sahib was appointed its first president. Today, this branch is divided into two branches, namely Bromley and Lewisham, and Bexley and Greenwich, and the members of these branches are going to benefit from this mosque. To achieve this, earnest prayers have been offered and many sacrifices made. Some gave away a large portion of their savings, women donated their jewelry, children handed in their pocket money, all in an effort to realize this dream. They deserve our thanks and prayers. But the raising of funds was not the only challenge we faced. There was also the very basic task of construction of this place, and here I must pay tribute to our national president, Mr. Rafiq Ahmed Hayat, who with the stewardship of Vice President Mr. Muhammad Nasir Khan and his team discharged this responsibility with great skill and efficiency. Islam is a religion that promotes positive human values that are universal, values such as tolerance for others, honesty, integrity, fairness and genuine concern for one's fellow human being. And these are qualities we found in abundance in the local council here. We are extremely thankful to the local council in the manner in which they have dealt with our planning application with understanding and kindness. May God reward them for that. This part of London has rich diversity of culture and incorporates people from a wide variety of religions and ethnic backgrounds. For our part, I can assure our representatives here from the council, the police, and the local churches is that in your efforts to build a peaceful, harmonious, and prosperous Lewisham, rich in diversity, you will find in us an enthusiastic and willing partner. Ladies and gentlemen, we are a relatively small community, but able to achieve much more than our size may suggest. It is this community, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that was the first Muslim community to be established in the United Kingdom. The first to build a mosque in London, the one that has built the largest mosque in Western Europe in Morden, and now has achieved the construction of this mosque here today. We believe that all this success is due to the favors of Almighty God and through the leadership he proves in the form of Khilafat. It is benign and benevolent kind of leadership that unites us. It gives us a sense of common purpose and enable all our energies to focus on whatever task they may be on hand. It was our present incumbent to this office of Khilafat, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, who first introduced to us the vision of building the mosque like this. It must have seemed like an impossible dream to some then. We hadn't even suffered the credit crunch at that time or subsequent financial tribulations. But despite these, with Hazur's prayers, inspiration and guidance, we have been able to realize this dream. So from the bottom of my heart to the person who deserves our gratitude most of all, I thank you, Hazur, for your kindness. Wassalam.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is our local MP for Lewisham East, Heidi Alexander. She's a member of the Communities and Local Government Select Committee and sits on the Regulatory Reform Committee. She's the personal private secretary to Mary Cree MP, who is the Shadow Secretary of State for the Environment, Food and Rural Affairs. Before entering Parliament at the 2010 general election, Heidi was the full-time deputy mayor for Lewisham Borough Council and the cabinet member for Regeneration. A local councillor for 6 years, Heidi was also an unpaid director of a number of companies, including Greater London Enterprise and Lewisham's Local Education Partnership. I have great pleasure in inviting Heidi to say a few words.
Ladies and gentlemen, Your Holiness, can I say what an enormous privilege and honour it is for me to be invited here to share in the celebrations of the opening of your new mosque. I think one of the things that makes Lewisham and Catford a special place to live is the tolerance and respect that the people who live here have for others, for other people's beliefs, for other people's values. As has already been said, we are a part of London that is home to people from all over the world, many of whom have different religions, and I'm very pleased that the Ahmadi community is now part of our community here. When I was asked to come along to the opening of the mosque a few weeks ago, Mr. Butt asked me if I would nominate a local charity to receive a donation from the Ahmadi community. I think it was as a symbol and a gesture of their commitment to working with everyone in the local community, the local society, and a gesture of how they want to make sure that everyone comes together to make this part of London a better place for everyone to live. I decided to nominate Lewisham Youth Aid, which is a charity that works with young people based in Catford. They've been established for the last 40 years, and I'm very pleased that Mercy Addo, who is the chair of Lewisham Youth Aid, can be with us this evening. And I know that one of the core values of what Lewisham Youth Aid do is how they're a very inclusive organisation working with young people from many different backgrounds. And so I thought it was fitting for the very, very generous donation that the Ahmadi community have offered to go to Lewisham Youth Aid. So can I say a huge thank you for their generosity. I'm so pleased to see many of you familiar faces from the local community here this evening. I wish the Ahmadi community all the best in your new home, and I look forward to working with them in the months and years to come, and to getting to know them better as you become a part of our community. So thank you very much for inviting me, and I look forward to working with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Heidi. Our next speaker is Steve Bullock, who was elected as the Lewisham's first directly elected mayor in May 2002, and he's now in his third term of office. Immediately prior to becoming mayor, he was serving as chair of the University Hospital Lewisham NHS Trust. Steve was first elected as councillor in 1982 and served as leader of Lewisham Council from 1988 to 1993. He is currently chair of the Local Government Association's Workforce Programme Board and leads on Housing for London Councils. He recently joined the board of the Museum of London. Mayor Bullock was knighted in 2007, and I therefore have great pleasure in requesting Sir Steve Bullock to come and address.
Ladies and gentlemen, Your Holiness, it is a real pleasure to be here tonight to be part of this great celebration of the opening of the Ahmadiyya Mosque here in Lewisham. As you've just heard, I've been around quite a long time, and the building is one which I'm quite familiar with in its previous existence, and it is a pleasure to see it being used in this very powerful way today. I would like to echo some of the things that Heidi was saying around the nature of our community. Lewisham is a place where we value the contribution that our faith organisations make. There are, I think the last time we tried to count, something like 200 faith organisations in the borough of Lewisham. And I have to say, in those 10 years that I have been mayor, the contributions that those organisations, those groups have made has been outstanding. We do face a challenging time, and knowing that we have faith organisations who demonstrate on a daily basis that the tenets of their faiths are actually being put into practice is of extreme importance to the whole of our community. And therefore it is a very great pleasure to be seeing the moving forward of the Ahmadiyya community. I know that you have had a presence in our borough for very many years, but I also know enough about how organisations work to know that having a home of your own is a very great step forward and often enables the organisation, the group, to go on and do much more in the future. And I'm sure that I will have the opportunity to visit the mosque in the future, and I look forward to working with you. Heidi has spoken about her nominated charity. Probably most of you will know that the mayor's nominated charity is the Lavender Trust, a charity which specialises in working with younger women who suffer from breast cancer, and it was set up by a former councillor in Lewisham who sadly fell victim herself to breast cancer, and we're very grateful for the contribution to that. Thank you very much indeed, and as I say, I look forward to working with the community in the years ahead, and in particular to visiting the mosque when it is working on an everyday basis as opposed to the very special occasion this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. There will now be a cheque presentation by His Holiness to the nominated charities for the MP's charity, and I request Amisa to conduct this. This is a figure of £2,500, and it's been donated to the MP's charity, which is the Lewisham Youth Aid charity.
Thank you very much.
And the second presentation is to the Lavender Trust, which is the mayor's charity, and that's also for £2,500.
Thank you very much. It's up to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to announce with my great pleasure that our spiritual leader is now going to address you.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. All our guests, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Peace and blessing of Allah be upon you all. We are all gathered here today for the inauguration of our new Tahir Mosque in this part of London. The Ahmadi Muslims who live in the surrounding area have had a long-standing and deeply held desire for an Ahmadi mosque and center to be built here in this area. This is because they wanted a place where they could join together to worship God Almighty, and where their spiritual and religious well-being could be facilitated. Therefore, for the Ahmadi Muslims who live in this area, certainly this mosque is of great significance and holds great value. Here I should mention that the construction of this mosque would not have been possible without the help and support given to us by the local council, the local authorities, and the local people themselves. For this reason, I would like to take this opportunity to first of all thank all of the people who have fully cooperated and assisted with the building of this mosque, despite not being the member of the Ahmadiyya community. At the outset, I would also like to thank all of you, our distinguished guests, who are attending the opening of the mosque today. Through this kind gesture, you have made it quite apparent that although you do not share the same religious beliefs as the Ahmadiyya community, you are willing to set aside such differences because you have such high regard for the importance of human values and the need to care for and respect the feelings of others. And you are people who share both in the happiness and in the grief of others. These are the core values which elevate the status of mankind. And it is these qualities which are essential for the spread of love and affection in today's world. The teaching of Islam on religion are very clear. We Muslims are commanded that every person's religion is a matter strictly between him and God Almighty. Our holy book, the Holy Quran, is very clear that there should be no compulsion in religion. Nevertheless, putting religion to one side, it is absolutely essential for each and every person to fulfill the rights owed to his fellow man, because this is the only way that an atmosphere of peace, reconciliation, and harmony can be developed. A question that is often asked is, how should people who are not religious be treated? We believe that this will be determined by God Almighty in the hereafter and is a matter for God alone to decide. But on the other hand, there are people who continually destroy the peace of society because they fail to discharge the due rights of other people. Such people will also face God's punishment in the next world. But apart from this, they are also normally brought to justice in this world. In his holy book, the Holy Quran, God Almighty has started with the following words, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. This translates as, all praise belongs to Allah, Lord of all the worlds. The words thus teach us that God is that being who is the Lord of all the worlds, and it is He who nurtures and sustains the entire universe. The Arabic word alam that is used here includes all nations of the world and also entails different eras and time periods. These few words are repeated by Muslims in every prayer. Indeed, not just in every prayer, but at the start of every single unit that is called rakab, of every prayer. Thus, for every true Muslim, there is an extremely important lesson contained in these words, which is that man should always remember that he is the creation of God and that God Almighty is always watching him. It is He alone who we worship because God is the Lord of all the worlds, who has created everything and sustains it. And the Holy Quran has further taught that humans are very best of God's creation. The sun, air, water, and countless other things, both in the earth and in the atmosphere, have been commissioned to serve God's creation. Because mankind is the best of creation, humans have been given superiority in comparison to other life forms. And so other forms of living beings have been made subservient to man. They have essentially been designed to serve mankind and so ensure the continuing sustenance of human beings in the most excellent manner. Some of these facilities and blessings are granted equally to all of mankind without discrimination and are not dependent upon a person's religion or whether he even believes in the existence of God. Thus, God Almighty, in His grace, has designated many blessings equally to all people, regardless of their caste, religion, creed, or faith. And from these blessings, all humans derive benefit. Nonetheless, certain people have a special relationship or association with God Almighty. Who are the people? It is those people who show gratitude to God and who bow down before Him because of all the blessings and favors that He has granted them. Such people truly believe Him to be their Lord and have accepted all of His prophets. These are the people who are recipients of His special favors. The results of this mutual relationship and bond are witnessed in this world on a daily basis. And then upon death, such people are again granted special treatment by God Almighty. Therefore, another reason that Muslims repeatedly recite the prayer, Lord of all the worlds, is so that man realizes that within his own circle of influence, a Muslim should seek to adopt the attributes of God to whatever extent he is capable. That is why we recite this prayer again and again. That is why we start every unit of our prayer with this supplication and repeat it in our prayers at least 32 times each day. Keeping this in view, it is essential that a Muslim should never usurp the rights of others, and instead he should cast aside all differences of religion, nationality, or ethnicity, and seek to become the means of support and love for all others. A Muslim should seek to utilize all of his faculties and abilities to help and serve his fellow man. Each Muslim should try his utmost to provide all other people with their due rights. In every prayer a Muslim offers, he is also reminded that God is both gracious and merciful. Gracious means that God continually bestows his creation with favors and of his own love, and even without being requested. And by merciful, it means that God is also he who responds to the prayers and requests of his creation. God Almighty has instructed a true Muslim to try and come to reflect God's own attributes. And so it is the duty of a Muslim to show mercy to his fellow man and indeed all other forms of creation. For this reason, if someone comes to a Muslim for help, then it is the duty of the Muslim to try and fulfill that need. Bearing all this in mind, can a true Muslim who believes in God and who worships Him in the proper way ever contemplate usurping the rights of another? How can it be possible when he knows that he will be liable to punishment for failing to follow God's commandments? On the one hand, God Almighty has provided so many provisions for the well-being and sustenance of his creation. So how, on the other hand, can it be possible that a true Muslim who claims to believe in God should then try to destroy the lives of God's creation? As I said, it is impossible for a true Muslim to act in this way, because such acts are contrary to God's laws. We Ahmadi Muslims claim to have accepted the Imam of this era, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, who we believe to be the Promised Messiah. It was he who founded our community, and he shined a light on true teachings of Islam. Having accepted him, we act upon the real teachings that a true Muslim ought to. That is why we who are his followers use all our resources and capabilities to provide provisions to people in need, irrespective of differences of nationality or religion. In addition, we are also providing health and education services in various parts of the world. Our goal is to serve humanity wherever we can. We do so not due to any vested interests, but only due to our to seek God's pleasure and nearness. When Ahmadi Muslims enter mosques, their primary purpose is the worship of God. Apart from this, the only other point of discussion is trying to find ways and means to help and serve humanity. Or perhaps the Ahmadi Muslims will be involved in deep reflection that our Khalifa has launched such and such scheme for the betterment of mankind, so how can we contribute towards this project? Therefore, where on the one hand our mosques unite people for the worship of God, they are also a place where we collectively endeavor to join together in an effort to serve humanity. In summary, we believe that mosques have two overarching purposes. First is the worship of God Almighty, and second is to be a place where projects are planned to help God's creation. Both of these purposes are essential and should be undertaken with the aim of seeking only God's pleasure. We certainly believe that any mosque devoid of these two aspects is not fulfilling its true purpose. Having heard all of this, I am sure you will agree with me that if these are the true and real purposes of a mosque, then there should be a mosque in every area. We often find that upon just hearing the word mosque, or upon hearing that planning permission for a mosque has been submitted to the local council, the local non-Muslims sometimes, or in most of the area, become worried and indeed frightened. They become anxious that if a mosque is built in their area, then peace of the town could be destroyed. Therefore, they try their utmost to prevent permission for the mosque or center to be built. If truth be told, then this fearful frame of mind is justified. I agree, because some Muslim groups are undoubtedly destroying the peace of the world. However, the acts of a few people should not be classed as the norm. Indeed, the action of just a handful of misguided people should not be used as a pretext to raise objections against our religion and to hurt the sentiments of the sincere and innocent Muslims of the world. Peace in society is a two-way process and can only be established if all parties work together towards mutual reconciliation. This is why every individual in a society, irrespective of his background, has a role to play towards achieving this goal. We believe in the founders and prophets of all religions. And because of this, a true Muslim can never mock or ridicule any religious leader or religion itself. In fact, the Holy Quran teaches that a Muslim must protect the places of worship of all religions, be they churches, synagogues, temples, or any other place of worship. Without any doubt, the true teachings of Islam are peaceful and beautiful, and so when it is ridiculed, it can only lead to the feelings of Muslims being hurt. Hurting the feelings of innocent people, I am sure you will agree, is unjust and wrong. When sentiments are deeply wounded, then even decent and sincere people can display an inappropriate or negative reaction, through which the peace of society will be harmed. The people who display the wrong reaction are certainly in error, but those who provoke them are just as responsible for the breakdown in peace. Today, we, the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, are trying to bring peace in the world. We are playing our role and trying to fulfill our responsibilities in this regard. And so, I would request all of you to join us in this task. Human values and mutual love can be developed even where differences of belief exist, as long as we all cooperate and respect each other. Today, the world stands in need of peace. The flames of war that we observe around us is a matter of concern for the world. If these flames spread to a larger area, then we will witness the eruption of Third World War. Thus, in every direction and at every level, we must try our best to extinguish the flames of hatred, and if we are successful in this task, only then will we be able to guarantee the bright futures of our coming generations. So today, we must set aside our own personal desires and instead be concerned for the future existence and well-being of our next generations. We must adopt selflessness rather than selfishness. When we all join together and come to respect each other, each other's feelings and sentiments, then and only then will an atmosphere of mutual love develop. It is then that we will truly see the beautiful society that all peaceful people desire. Alongside of this, to safeguard our future generations, it is essential that we remember that it is God who has created us. It is He who loves His creation, and it is He who desires the prosperity and success. And it is because of all of this that He has granted us countless favors and blessings through His eternal grace. It is my sincere prayer that each and every one of us become a good and sincere person. Ameen. In the end, I would like to express my gratitude to all of the guests once again who have sacrificed their time to be with us today and whose presence has enlightened the event. May Allah reward all of you for this abundantly. Thank you very much.